So I bring you greetings, first of all from the church that I worship at, which is called the Pavilion Christian Community, which meets in Bourneville. And just in case you don't know where Bourneville is, it's the place where Cadbury's chocolate is made. So we have sweet smelling services. We actually worship in a community centre that we now operate on behalf of the community, which was built by George Cadbury for his workers. So it's actually a very interesting place, set in the middle of a wonderful park. So we have 45 acres of land to look after. And we have 2,500 people a week using the community centre, and in the midst of that, a growing church. So I bring you greetings from the congregation that I normally would be meeting at. I also bring you greetings from the college, for Mission College. So we like the name because there's no doubt at all about what we are for. We're absolutely for mission. That is what we do. That is the centre, the beating heart of who we are. So, good to be with you this morning, and let me just add a couple of words about my background so that you get a bit of a feeling of where I'm coming from, and then we'll start in with the message. So, I was born in India. My parents were missionaries in India, and as a matter of fact, I went back to my birthplace for the first time since we left when I was a child. I went back a few weeks ago. And so that was a very emotional experience to visit the place where I was born. When I was quite young, we returned to the United Kingdom, and my father was a church planter in Scotland. And just in case you're in any doubt, Scotland is a very different nation than England. And because my parents were from London, I was a bit of a reject, if you see what I mean, because the Scottish people were very suspicious about these English people coming up to Scotland. But eventually I spoke just like a Scot, not like I speak now. I spoke with a broad Glaswegian accent, which meant that when in my mid-teens we moved to Leicester, I had a bit of a problem because nobody could understand a word I was saying. So guess what? I was an outsider yet again. So I had to learn how to deal with my new context. And then in my late teens, early 20s, I trained for the ministry, spent a third of my working life replanting a church in inner city Birmingham. It's a very multiracial congregation. It was a great experience. And then from there, we planted other churches in different parts of Birmingham. So the first third of my life was spent as a church planter. And then, as David indicated, the second third of my working life was working for the Bible Society, trying to figure out what it means to do mission in a Western European context. And then for the last 15 years, I've been working to try and train people for the mission field in this country and across Europe. We currently have about 220 students on our validated programs and probably 50 or 60 on some of our other programs. So it's a healthy, growing, and vibrant college. So good to be with you this morning. I'm a kind of Anglo-Indian Scot with a passion for mission. So this morning, I want to talk to you a little bit about a particular issue that's a passion of mine because I'm very privileged to be able to travel around the world and to talk to Christian leaders. And when you move outside of the United Kingdom, when you move outside of Europe and talk to leaders, two things become apparent. First of all, the Church of Jesus Christ is growing faster today than it has ever grown in the whole history of mankind. It's a very exciting time to be a Christian. Whether it's India or whether it's China or whether it's Indonesia or whether it's South American nations or whether it's African nations, especially south of the Sahara, the Church of Jesus Christ is on the move. So that's very apparent. I was talking just the other day, I think it was Thursday of this week, to a young man who is an Iranian, a Muslim background, just become a Christian. And he said to me, you know, I'm pretty convinced that if the government of Iran ever was to change from being a Muslim government, if people had free will, He said, I'm pretty convinced from what I know of the people in Iran that 70% would become Christians overnight. It's a wonderful time to be a Christian. So that's the first thing I learned. The second thing I learned is that actually, although it's relatively easy in many parts of the world for people to become believers in Christ, believers in Jesus, believers in God, actually it's much more difficult for them to figure out how to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. So becoming a believer is easy, but being a follower, a true disciple of Jesus, is much more problematic. So this morning, I want to just spend some time thinking about that core question. What does it mean to be a disciple of Jesus? Now, as a matter of fact, I heard this concern from so many leaders around the world that I even began to wonder if I might write a book on this subject. I've written a number of books, and I thought this would be a good subject. And so before I got very far down that track, I thought I'd better see who else has written about the subject of discipleship. So when you want to see about books on discipleship, what would you do? How would you find out what's been written? What would you do? You'd Google it, wouldn't you? Absolutely, you'd Google it. And in particular, you could take a shortcut and go straight to Amazon and put in the word disciple. And I was amazed to discover that if I did that, I came up, this was a few years ago, I think it's even more than this now, I came up with about 2,500 titles. And then I thought, well, I'll put in the word discipleship. That might be a few less. Well, actually, it was a few less, but only a couple of hundred less. Still a couple of thousand titles with discipleship in it. And I thought, well, what am I going to do? How am I going to survey 4,500 books on this sort of topic? It's impossible. And some of them I didn't want to look at anyway, because some of them were things like how to become a disciple of the devil. Well, I wasn't too interested in those titles. So what was I going to do? So I eventually had a bit of a brainwave. I thought, what I'm going to do before I do anything else, I'm going to go to the New Testament. I'm going to ask the question, what does Jesus say specifically about this topic? And then I got a surprise, because what I discovered is that when I went through the New Testament, there are only actually five passages in the whole of the New Testament, in all four Gospels, where Jesus specifically says, this is what a disciple is like. And I want to share those five scriptures with you this morning, if I may. And I see you're using the New Living Translation, which I love, actually. I don't often use it, but I saw you using it, and so I'm using it myself this morning. And if you'd turn with me, if you happen to have a Bible handy, if you'd turn with me to John's Gospel, John chapter 13, verses 34 and 35, these are the words we read. So now, this is Jesus speaking, so now I'm giving you a new commandment. Love each other. Just as I have loved you, you should love each other. Your love for one another will prove to the world that you're my disciples. So that's the first scripture to do with discipleship. Love is key to being a disciple. Love for one another. Now, the word love is a curious word in English, because in English, it has to cover a whole range of meanings, which in other languages would actually have a number of words. So in English, we only have the one word if it's love for mother, if it's love for children, if it's love for husband, wife, if it's love for friend, if it's love for all kinds of situations. We only have the word love. We don't have any other words to describe all these different kinds of love. And one of the problems with that in English is that it sometimes means that the word is so stretched, so overused, that actually it can seem to be a little bit of a weak word. Oh, I love that ice cream. Oh, I love this, I love that, I love everything else. It just seems like a very weak word, which is a pity, because actually what underlies that is something very powerful indeed. Just recently, my wife and I came in and we were just catching a few moments, eating a meal, watching a little bit of television before we went out to that most Christian of all activities, another meeting. And just before we did that, we happened to turn on the television and there was one of these programs, I don't know if you've ever seen these kinds of programs, where they gave you a trailer of a program where experts tell you how to bring up your children. Have you ever watched any of those programs? This particular one, this particular trailer was really caught my attention because there was a four-year-old boy, let's call him Johnny, and his behavior in the trailer was terrible. He was swearing at his mother, he was shouting at his mother, he was kicking his mother, he wouldn't do anything his mother said. And in the trailer, the expert said to his mother, "If you do what I say, your child's behavior is going to change completely." I thought, I can't believe that. I think I'll have to stay and watch this program. And I did watch the program, and here's what happened. At the very beginning of the program, the expert, the psychologist, said to the mother, "I've watched your child's behavior, and you've watched it with me on tape. Now, here's the thing. If you do what I say, your child's behavior is going to change very, very quickly. I'm only ever going to speak to you once. I'll give you some support if you need it. I never need to speak to your child, but that's the deal. You just do as I say, and everything's going to change." How is this possible? So the first thing he did after showing the tape back to the mother of how, just remind you of how the child had been behaving, Johnny had been behaving, he said to the mother, "What does Johnny want?" Good question, isn't it? What does Johnny want? And Johnny's mother, who is actually pretty perceptive, said, "Johnny wants to know that I love him." And the psychologist said to her, "And do you love him?" And she said, "No." And the psychologist said, "Well, why not?" She said, "Because when I knew that I was pregnant with Johnny, his father, my partner, walked out on me. And I was left to bring Johnny into this world alone, and I've been left to struggle ever since. And every time I look at Johnny, I'm reminded of the unfairness and of the pain and of the hurt I've been through. And so, no, I do not love him." And even in that moment, as she said those words, she realized that that was a burden that was far too great for a four-year-old boy to bear. And she resolved in her heart to change her attitude and to genuinely love Johnny. And within a week, Johnny's behavior was entirely different. Because all he had ever wanted to know was that his mother loved him. All he ever wanted to do was to have her attention and please his mother. Love. Just a small word. And yet actually an incredibly powerful reality. Because love has the capacity to change relationships. Love has the capacity to heal families. Love has the capacity to change communities. Love has the capacity to make a difference even to nations. And so this is what Jesus has to say. The first prerequisite, the first requirement, the first thing that we have to do as disciples of Jesus is figure out this small word and big reality. If you love one another, people will know that you're my disciples. Well, that's the first scripture. And the second scripture I want to take you to is taken from John chapter 8. John chapter 8. And again, if you have a Bible with you and you want to follow along, I'm going to read verses 30 to 32 in John chapter 8, and we read these words. Then many who heard him say these things, that's Jesus, believed in him. Jesus said to the people who believed him, "You are truly my disciples if you remain faithful to my teachings. And you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." Okay, so the emphasis here is on faithfulness. And what that's talking about is faithfulness, if you like, throughout your life. Because here's one of the problems. Very often in the Christian life, or just in ordinary life, actually we often expect an instant answer to everything, don't we? We live in a very instant world. I don't know whether it started when they introduced instant coffee, but we certainly live in an instant world. We're very impatient in all sorts of things. Tesco came out with a survey the other day, and they discovered that the average number of people that we're willing to tolerate in a queue in front of us is just 6. If the queue is longer than 6 people, they've discovered that in their stores, people will leave their shopping and just leave the store. Isn't that curious? We're so impatient. 6 is the maximum number of people ahead of us that we're willing to tolerate. We want everything now. We want to be served now. We want experiences now. We want pleasure now. We live in a world where we desire what the psychologists call instant gratification. Immediate satisfaction. And actually, that's quite damaging in terms of human development. Let me just give you a little illustration about this. I've got 4 grandchildren. I gather that your pastor here has 4 grandchildren too, because he's going to see the eldest one today, which is great. And when my 2 oldest grandchildren were sort of about 7 and about 4, I noticed that there was an interesting moment developing, a difference between them. And here's what was happening. When I had the 4-year-old and the 7-year-old in a room and I gave both of them sweets, what do you think the 4-year-old did with the sweets that I gave him? Yeah, he ate them very quickly indeed, yeah. Instant gratification. Curiously, the 7-year-old didn't do that. The 7-year-old decided that he would eat some, but he would keep some for later. Now, that's a small thing, but it marks a very important step in development, in human development, in child development, because there's the recognition that some things have to be saved for later. In other words, we have to invest in all sorts of ways, and that begins to apply to all sorts of areas of life. There are some things we do now where we don't expect to get the reward immediately. We are investing in the future, and that could apply to things we're learning at school. It could be things that we're learning at college. It could be all sorts of things that we do in life, not because we're going to get instant gratification, but because it is good for our future. And unfortunately, in this country, because we've not been very successful at teaching that to people, that very often what we've ended up with are adults who are in fact still children. Because what happens to some adults who haven't learned that principle? When they don't immediately get success, what do? They just give up. Instead of recognizing that actually resilience, investment in the future, is incredibly important. If at first you don't succeed, said my parents to me, if at first you don't succeed, try again. Absolutely. You do not give up. And what Jesus is talking about in this passage is that sort of principle. In other words, what he's looking for is not the immediate response that we have to our conversion or to coming to him. What he's looking for is, what are we going to be like? How are we going to be behaving? How are we going to be acting at the very end of our life? And how is that going to be a consistent pattern through our life? Because what Jesus is looking for in disciples is a consistency of obedience over time. If you remain faithful, you are truly my disciples. Well, that's the second scripture. I want to share with you a third scripture, which is also from John's Gospel. And it's John chapter 15, a very well-known passage. John chapter 15. And actually, I'm just going to look at verse 8. John chapter 15, verse 8. And you'll know this scripture very well. When you produce much fruit, you are my true disciples. This brings great glory to my Father. Fruit. It's an interesting idea, isn't it? Fruit. Actually, if you look at the whole passage here, what Jesus is talking about is the vine. And he's talking about the vine and the branches. And of course, the point about vines is that they produce something, don't they? And what do they produce? Grapes. We don't really see grapes very often in this country. We do see them occasionally. But it's something that you see more often in slightly warmer countries, for example, France. And actually, my wife and I very often go on holiday to France, and we particularly like those parts of France that happen to grow grapes. For example, the sort of Bordeaux area, which used to be owned by the English at one time. But for some strange reason, the French wanted it back. I'm not quite sure why. But it's a pity, because that's the best grape-growing area. And actually, I just love to drive, because we often go, obviously, in August, September, and that's just before the harvest. And so when you look at the grapes, they're just absolutely huge, big bunches of grapes, and they're so big and so heavy that they're kind of almost reaching to the ground. And sometimes I'm so fascinated by this that I'll stop the car and just go and look at the grapes. My wife thinks I'm strange in this regard, a few other regards as well, but that one particularly. And the other year we were in France, and I thought, do you know, I'm going to get a photograph. This particular bunch is so gorgeous, I'm going to take a photograph of it. And my wife said, what on earth are you doing? I said, I'm just getting a photograph of this bunch of grapes. She thought I was so crazy, she took a photograph of me taking a photograph of the grapes. Now, the point about the grapes, of course, is that they can be used in all sorts of ways. We can eat them directly, we can turn them into grape juice, we can turn them into wine, we can use them for all kinds of things. We can dry them and use them as raisins. But the point about grapes is that they are designed to be, quite literally in this case, fruitful. And so Jesus is looking at this analogy and he's saying, look, the whole point about a vine is not that it's leafy, not that it's got long tentacles of branches here, there, and everywhere. The whole point about all of that is only that they produce fruit. And the point about that is that actually, in order to produce fruit, strangely enough, you have to do something a bit odd. And I discovered what that was when one time I went down to France and I happened to go, unusually, in February. Now, when I got to the vineyards, I was staggered at what I saw, because instead of all these beautiful green areas in all these straight lines with all the fruit, all that had gone, and all that was left was these little blackened stubs. And I thought, my goodness, what has happened? Somebody's vandalized this whole area. And I was, again, out of the car just looking at this in utter dismay. And it happened that a farmer came along. And I said, what has happened here? And he said, well, the same thing that happens every year. We have to prune. We have to cut back. And actually, what you discover as somebody who's growing vines, that if you don't cut back, if you don't be a little bit harsh with the plant, actually, you just don't get good grapes the next year. And that's what Jesus is talking about in this particular passage. In order to get fruitfulness, you have to be willing to be cut back. And he's talking in this passage about all the stuff which is worthless, which is, in this case, was all the beautiful stuff, all the leaves, all the branches, all of that. That all goes. And actually, you can't use it for anything. It just has to be taken away and literally burnt, because the only thing that matters, in fact, is the fruit. And here's the problem for those of us who are wanting to be disciples. Actually, the word itself implies what's going on here. Disciple, discipline. Cutting back. Now, let's be honest, who is willing to put up their hand and say, I want to be disciplined. I want to be cut back. I want you to tell me what needs to be put right in my life. I want you to give me correction. I want you to give me the proper direction. Who is willing to do that? And yet that's what Jesus is really saying. If you want to be a disciple, then actually it's necessary from time to time to look at one's life and say, do you know what? There are probably some things that need cutting out. There are probably some things that need to be redirected. There are probably some things that actually are not fruitful in my life. And if I want to be truly fruitful, I have to be willing to be in an accountable relationship where my brothers and sisters are able to help me with those things that need to be cut back, not in order that I be damaged, far from it, but that in order that I might be healthy and produce much fruit. Isn't it the case that very often people want to be believers because they see that actually, if you're a believer, there's great blessings? Absolutely true. There are great blessings. It's a wonderful thing. Actually, I can't understand why somebody would not want to become a Christian. I mean, it's crazy, isn't it? The God of the universe, who has made you, who knows you better than you know yourself, who's formed you even before you were born, he knew you, and he's got a plan and a purpose for your life. That God is willing to come into your life and to bless you. And why wouldn't you want to accept that? You'd be crazy to turn down that offer, wouldn't you? But mixed in with the blessing is also the need for discipline, which is actually no more than learning how to grow up and be realistic about who we are and what we are and how our lives need to improve, actually for our own good. So that's the third scripture. Now, I said at the beginning, how many scriptures did I say?
Five.
All right, just checking that you're listening. Okay, so we're going to go on to the fourth scripture now. So the fourth scripture is actually, for the first time, we're going to leave John's gospel. We're going to go to Luke's gospel. And this is actually a much more difficult passage. It's a longer passage. I'm going to read all of it to you. It's a longer passage, but it's quite a difficult one. So just bear with me for a moment or two. It says here, the subheading is the cost of being a disciple. A large crowd was following Jesus. He turned around and said to them, if you want to be my disciple, you must hate everyone else by comparison. your father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, even your own life. Otherwise, you cannot be my disciple. And if you do not carry your own cross and follow me, you cannot be my disciple. But don't begin until you count the cost, for who would begin construction of a building without first calculating the cost to see if there's enough money to finish it? Otherwise, you might only complete the foundation before running out of money, and then everyone would laugh at you. They would say, there's the person who started that building and couldn't afford to finish it. Or what king would go to war against another king without first sitting down with his counselors to discuss whether his army of 10,000 could defeat the 20,000 soldiers marching against him? And if he can't, he will send a delegation to discuss terms of peace while the enemy is still far away. So, you cannot become my disciple without giving up everything you own. Whoa. There's a difficult passage. As a matter of fact, scholars who look at all the scriptures, they talk about the hard sayings of Jesus. And not surprisingly, this is one of the hard sayings of Jesus. And it's hard for two reasons. First of all, because it's hard to understand, and secondly, because it's hard to do. So let's just unpack that a little bit, because there's two aspects that Jesus is covering in this particular passage, this difficult passage. And the first is about our relationships. And what he's saying here is, he's not literally saying you have to hate your parents in order to be a Christian. He's not saying that, because we know that Jesus loved his mother. And we know that he also advocated that we honor our parents. So you can't honor your parents if you hate them. So is Jesus just getting confused here? Is he contradicting himself? What's actually going on here? And of course, the truth is that in all the hard sayings of Jesus, because he's dealing with difficult subjects, it's a bit like when you have to correct a panel. I've got one of my students is a panel beater. And I said, what does that involve exactly? And he said, well, I literally have to beat a panel. And I have to beat it hard, because when it's damaged, in order to get it right, you have to give it quite a lot of force to get it to come straight. I thought, that's interesting. That's what Jesus is doing, isn't it? In terms of these hard sayings, he's actually hitting the subject really hard in order that we might come straight. So we don't take this literally. We don't say, oh yes, I've got to go out and start hating my parents. We don't take it literally. But what we do listen to is the reality that we don't get so caught up with our human relationships that they take a false priority. So, for example, sometimes parents in our church, actually, there's lots of sports go on around our community center, and sports are a really good thing. But I get sad when sometimes parents say to me, well, I'm not going to be coming to church anymore because I've got to be with my son or my daughter to do sports with them, and it happens to be on a Sunday morning. I think, I understand that, but actually, there's a wrong modeling going on here. You know, there are Saturday mornings when you can do sport. And to deprive your children of spiritual nourishment just so that they can have some physical nourishment, I just think that's the wrong priority. But it's very easy to argue ourselves into all these kinds of positions. I had another young man come to me and he said, oh, I won't be at church next Sunday. I said, oh, why is that? He said, oh, well, I've got very important examinations and I have to study. So, you know, I won't be at church on Sunday because I need to study. So I said, oh, okay, fine. What are you doing on Saturday night? Oh, he said, I'm going out to a party. Yeah, right, okay. You see, what Jesus is getting at is that actually there's a hierarchy of priorities here. And what he's basically saying is, look, the calling upon us is to get this structure right. And so the first structure is this. We actually put God first. And when we place God first, all the other things actually properly come into focus. One of the things that disturbs me slightly in the Western world is that men have given up on their responsibility for the spiritual welfare of their family. Actually, that's the first priority for a father. And too many men look at faith and look at religion and look at Christianity and they say, oh, that's for the women. It's not for the women alone. It's time for men to be men and accept spiritual responsibility for their family. Yes, women have a part to play in that, but don't put all the weight on women. Take your proper place. And this is what Jesus is saying, and this is why he's having to hit it so hard. And that applies in all areas of our life. So it applies to all the other things that we chase after and we think are so important, our careers, how we spend our time, how we spend our money, all the things to do with our plans and our priorities and our possessions. Jesus is really saying, look, if you want to be a disciple of mine, get these things in the proper order. Because interestingly, that's how you live a fulfilled life. It's curious, isn't it? Often, those who are clergy get the privilege of being with those who are about to die. And it is a privilege, actually, because often you can reflect with people on how they've lived their life. And I can absolutely guarantee that no one has ever said to me, I wish I'd spent more time at the office. But nearly everybody says, I wish I'd spent more time cultivating the important relationships with my family, with my friends. I wish I'd spent more time figuring out, they might not use these words, but what they're really saying is, what did God really intend for my life? What was I put on this earth to do and to be? That's really where the regrets come. And so Jesus is saying, get your life in order. Get your priorities straight, because that's what will help you to be a disciple of mine. And then lastly, Matthew's Gospel, Matthew chapter 10 and verses 24 and the first part of 25. And actually, this particular passage uses the word student rather than disciple, but that's what a student is. Some versions of the Bible say disciple, some say students. So I'm going to stick with the word student, but you have to think of it as a disciple. Students, disciples, are not greater than their teacher, and slaves are not greater than their master. Students are to be like their teacher, and slaves are to be like their master. And what Jesus is getting at here is, look, very often when people become Christians, very often when they become followers of Jesus, they start to enter into some new experiences. Now, one of the great things about becoming a Christian is you begin to experience and notice answered prayer. It's wonderful. It's amazing. Wow. God hears my prayers and answers them. This is amazing. And very often you see, especially with new Christians, that all kinds of things that have been problems in their lives begin to get sorted out relatively quickly. And they go, this is amazing. How come nobody ever told me about this before? And there's a moment of great joy there, but there's also a moment of potential problem, because actually the point about being a Christian is not that you're introduced to God as some kind of celestial Father Christmas. He is not there simply to give you all your desires and all your hopes and all your dreams as a kind of Santa Claus. That is not what God's purpose is. Yes, he is good. Yes, he's gracious. Yes, he's loving. And yes, he will answer many of your prayers. But sometimes the answer is no, not yes. There's still an answer. But he knows what's good for us. And what he's really wanting from those who follow him is not that we will moan and groan every time we don't get our prayers answered. Oh, I don't know. You know, one of my relatives died. She was 95, but how could God let such a thing happen? I'm not going to be a follower of Jesus anymore. You ever heard people talk like that? I didn't get everything I want, so I'm giving up this Christianity business. And Jesus is saying, look, that's not what it's about. What it's about is that in all of your walk with me, in all of your conversation with me, your talk with me, your walk with me, your talk with me, I want you to learn how to become like me. Not just to receive from me, but to actually become like me. A few years ago, we had a funeral in our church, and it was a lady who was not particularly old when she died. She was only 65, which these days is young. I'm over 65, very young. And it was interesting because she was one of those people that would normally not be noticed in life. She'd had a difficult life. She was brought up in a home in Scotland where she'd been ill all her life. She hadn't been able to attend school. She'd had a poor education. Because she'd had a poor education, she hadn't been able to get a very good job. And because she hadn't been able to get a very good job, she was always poor. And, you know, everything about Helen's life would say, here is somebody whose life has been difficult and potentially miserable. But here's the thing, Helen was happy. Not only was she happy, but she just loved to talk to people about Jesus. Because Jesus had made a difference to her life. And it didn't matter whether she was in a shop or in a bus queue or talking to her neighbors or whoever she was talking to. She always found a way of turning the conversation around to the great things that God was doing for her. It's curious that when Helen's funeral came, the church was absolutely packed. And when I talked to the people who had come, some of whom many of whom I didn't know actually, they were her neighbors and friends and all sorts of people that she'd bumped into along the way. This is kind of their report. They didn't use these exact words, but what they were trying to say is the reason we wanted to come to Helen's funeral, we loved her, and we loved her because when we talked to Helen, it felt like we were talking to Jesus. Isn't that interesting? Through all her difficulties in life, through all of her shortcomings and hardships, actually what shone through was the character of the one she followed. And that's what Jesus is really trying to say in this passage. He's trying to say, look, the ultimate outcome of being a disciple is not necessarily about wealth and blessing, even though those things might well come. The ultimate outcome is that actually you be more like me, so that those who come across you, so that those who know you, so that those who converse with you actually begin to see not just you, but Jesus in you. So if you were to take these five scriptures and sum them up, I think what we're really saying is this: a disciple of Jesus Christ is somebody who loves others, who is obedient, who is fruitful, who places the right priorities in their lives, and ultimately seeks to become more and more like Jesus. Amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching videos at gbcweb.tv.